Good evening. Welcome to the second section of the Chamber Chats with the Judges series, organized by the Lui Shi Wu Law Library and the General Education Unit of the University of Hong Kong. I'm the moderator of the event tonight. My name is Stephen Kern, fourth year student from the Faculty of Law. The English common law was introduced into Hong Kong as the basis of the legal system in the 1840s, when Hong Kong was ceded to the British. It has remained in force after the handover in 1997 under the constitutional principle of one country, two systems. As with the situations in other colonies, the English common law in Hong Kong has been modified to suit local circumstances, including the use of Chinese. From that, we can see the foresight and determination of the Faculty of Law demonstrated in the year 1987 when it launched a new course on the use of Chinese in law. Tonight, we are honored to have the Honorable Mr. Justice Patrick Chan and Professor Johannes Chan to share with us their experience on the topic, the English common law in the Chinese setting. Our speaker of tonight, Mr. Justice Patrick Chan, was born and raised in Hong Kong. After graduating from the University of Hong Kong in 1975, he practiced as a barrister until 1987, when he joined the judiciary as a district judge. He was appointed a High Court judge in 1992, the Chief Judge in 1997, and a permanent judge of the Court of Final Appeal in the year 2000. He retired in 2013 and now continues as a non-permanent judge of the Court of Final Appeal. Throughout his legal career, Justice Chan has been actively involved in the development of a bilingual legal system, as well as legal education and training in Hong Kong. In recognition of his contribution to the well-being of Hong Kong, in 2013, Justice Chan was awarded the Grand Bohemia Medal, the highest award under the HKSAR Honours and Awards System. Our facilitator of tonight, Mr. Johannes Chan, is a professor of law and the former dean of the Faculty of Law. He is a practicing barrister at law, specializing in human rights, constitutional and administrative law. In recognition of his contribution to legal development through advocacy in courts, legal research and publication, he has been awarded by the Chief Justice in the year 2003 as the first and so far the only honorary senior counsel in Hong Kong. Before the talk begins, may we now invite Professor Chan to say a few words to us. Professor Chan, please.
Justice Chan, honorable guests, ladies and gentlemen, I am asked just to say a few words to give a more personal introduction to our speaker tonight, Mr. Justice Patrick Chan, which is my honor to do so. I've known Patrick for many, many years now in many different capacities, and Patrick may not remember that in those days when we study at the law school, we have to do a compulsory dissertation. So in my second year, I have to find a topic to do a dissertation, so I decide to write on public order ordinance. And then I found that a few years ago, Patrick has already done a dissertation on exactly the same topic. And after I read his dissertation, I was at a loss because I don't know what else I could say after his comprehensive dissertation. So I decided to ask him for advice, and he was still in private practice at that time, and Patrick has given me some very useful advice, which probably Patrick has forgotten by now. It was almost 40 years ago. And in the late 80s, when the future of Hong Kong was troubling a lot of people, and when emigration has almost reached its height in the early 90s, and a lot of people have been thinking of leaving Hong Kong, Patrick thinks of how he could continue to contribute to Hong Kong, and he decided that the way he could make some contribution is to join the judiciary. And since joining the judiciary, he has made a lot of impact on the judicial system. And among other things, as Stephen has mentioned, Patrick has always been a strong supporter for developing a bilingual legal system in Hong Kong. and it is easier said than done, given that our legal traditions and the training has all been done in English. To shift to a Chinese mode require not just techniques or language skills, but also it is a change of culture, a change of habit, and to overcome our inertia and to change the entire mode of thinking. And Patrick has introduced many reforms and methods to try to overcome that kind of psychological reluctance to use Chinese. He has promoted the use of Chinese language among his judicial peers, and he himself set the example by hearing many cases, not only when he was a district judge, high court judge, and then court of appeal, and then finally court of final appeal. He has probably delivered more Chinese judgment than any other judges. And I still recall that when the Court of Final Appeal has delivered a very controversial decisions in Nka Ling, and it was there was a big concern about some quarters of the community would not be able to understand the judgment, and the Chief Justice has asked a few of us to try to translate it and provide an official translation of that judgment. Patrick and I was involved in that process, and I remember we spent many hours pondering what exactly the Court of Final Appeal is trying to say. And in the translation, the problem of translating an English judgment, or for that matter any English documents into Chinese, sometimes is not the difficulty about terminology, not about the difficulty of the English language also, but rather is to translate what has not been said. For example, the use of passive voice, how do you translate into Chinese, which may require a subject there and involve inevitably some kind of interpretation there. And Patrick has also made major contributions to legal education. In 1997, when the law school set up the program of Master of Common Laws and tried to train judges from the mainland, we need to give judges an exposure to how our legal system works. And Patrick again came to our help and tried to twist the arms of his judicial colleagues to take on judges as judicial interns and gave them that valuable experience of first-hand knowledge of how our judicial system works, what does it mean by the rule of law in the practical context. And he is the chairman of the Standing Committee on Legal Education, and in that respect, he contributed also to the further development of legal education. And I sat on that committee in my capacity as dean, and I have many hours learning from the wisdom and experience of Patrick. He's also a member of our Hong Kong Youth Council and a member of our Audit Committee, and at some time in the past 12 months, I thought that had Patrick still on the council, probably the council would have done better than what they have done in the last 12 months. And he's also a member and a mentor to many generations of law students, and Patrick has always been very generous with his time to share his experience and wisdom with law students. And just now Patrick asked me to be brief on him, and the simple way to introduce him is he's a retired and now unemployed person. And unemployed simply means that he is doing all sorts of meaningful work without pay, and among other things he still provides teaching, and he also teach a course at the Chinese Universities of Law and Politics in Beijing, which represents his continuous efforts to benefit the younger generation of law students. So with that, let's introduce Patrick in our usual way.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Professor Chan, two Professor Chans, Professors Litton and the Bureau Librarian, Stephen and honorable guests. I am indeed honored to be invited to share with you some of my thoughts in the relevant area of the law. Thank you very much for coming tonight. When I was deciding what to talk about this evening, I spoke to Rebecca, and she kindly suggested a topic to me, and we did come up with with this topic, the English common law in Chinese setting. Then I realized that in fact this topic had been, or similar topic had been discussed, had been written on by a number of persons. One of the first persons would probably be Professor David Evans, who was the head of the Department of Law when I was a law student. And there were subsequently Professor Xi, Professor Chen, and in fact a lot of people. But unfortunately, some of them actually wrote on this topic, on Chinese law and custom, while some concentrated on the use of Chinese. So what I thought was, perhaps I could sort of marry the two and discuss with you sort of a continuum. And the more common thread was actually the common law adapting to local circumstances. What I intend to do is to look at our local legal system from a wider perspective than anything else. And I would like to examine briefly what had happened to shape our legal system and what we do, what do we want to do from our. The legal system of a place is usually developed within the framework of its culture and tradition. And such culture and tradition is reflected in the contents of the law and the form of its legal system. The common law, and I include the rules of equity, has developed for centuries in England, where the culture, the tradition, and even the language are completely different from those in Hong Kong. Now, at the time of session, Hong Kong already has its own laws and legal system applying Chinese law and custom. Since then, as a result of the differences in culture, tradition, and language, this system has evolved first into a dual system of law, then a common law system with a dual aspect of the law, and now moving to a bilingual common law system, which is unique in the common law world. I shall explain briefly. I'm sure that you have actually heard of most of the things which I want to say this evening, but maybe you'll be patient for a while. First of all, the dual system. We start from the Treaty of Nanking, or Nanjing, as it is now called, signed in 1842 and ratified in 1843. Under Article 3, Hong Kong was, among other things, to be governed, and I quote, by such laws and regulations as Her Majesty the Queen of Great Britain, etc., etc., Northern Ireland, etc., shall see fit to direct. There was no saving of the existing laws and customs of the inhabitants in Hong Kong. Whatever was intended, this simple formula simply did not provide any answer at all. Was it the English common law? Was it the British Action Parliament? Or was it the Chinese law and custom? Or a combination of all these? Now, even before this treaty was signed, however, the first proclamation was issued by Captain Elliot, and that was done on the 29th of January, 1841, but somehow dated the 2nd of February of that year. It provided, among other things, that, and I quote, natives of China were to be governed according to the laws and customs of China, every description of torture excepted. Now, this was followed by a second proclamation issued on the 1st of February by the same person to the same effect, albeit with a slightly different wording. It may be opened to debate as to whether there was any practical difference between what was intended by the first proclamation and what was intended by the second. However, it was sufficiently clear that Chinese inhabitants were to be governed not by English law, but by the then existing laws, Chinese law and customs. Although this was to be subject to the further pleasure of the Queen. But for non-Chinese and British subjects and other foreigners, the first proclamation further provided that they were subject to the criminal, and I quote, an admiralty jurisdiction than existing in China. Surprising. And the British law. This was not, as I said, surprising, but some regard it as not surprising at all, because way back in 1833, there was already an ordering council which set up a British court in China with criminal and admiralty jurisdiction over British subjects within China, which at that time, before the accession, extended to Hong Kong. So we have this dual system. It was described as an interim administrative measure by Mr. Strickland, a former Solicitor General, in his 1953 committee report. There was support for this arrangement from an academic, Professor Green, who writing about the position in India, took the view that, and I quote, an immediate application of existing law could easily produce anarchy. Now, the legality of the Elliot proclamations were actually disavowed by Lord Palmerston, the then British Foreign Secretary. There were two reasons. First, Captain Ely's authority to make them was not clear at all. And secondly, they were issued even before the signing and ratification of the Nanking Treaty of Nanking. That is, even before there was a formal official recognition of the cession. But notwithstanding this, these proclamations were to have far-reaching effects as they were considered as providing support for the incorporation of Chinese law and custom into our legal system. However, the basis of these proclamations was they have been generally accepted and acted upon. For example, pursuant to the first proclamation, a warrant was issued for the appointment of a chief magistrate who was to apply, among other things, the Chinese law and custom to Chinese inhabitants. So, the dual system. This was short-lived. It was criticized by the Home Department later as having broken down, the system broke down, and was abandoned actually in 1843. It was then decided to apply the English law to all inhabitants, whatever the race and nationality. This was done not arbitrarily, but after the establishment of the first Legislative Council on the 5th of April 1843, and it was done not in application of English law ordinance, but in the Supreme Court ordinance, Ordinance 15 of 1844. And that ordinance set up the Supreme Court. And Section 3 declared, and I quote, because this is important, the law of England shall be in full force in the said colony of Hong Kong, except where the same shall be inapplicable to the local circumstances of the said colony or its inhabitants. However, the same provision continued to provide that in all criminal proceedings in which the parties proceeded against the Chinese, are Chinese, or of Chinese extraction, whatever that means, the offenders may be punished according to the laws of China. So again, very strange. Apply Chinese law, apply English law, but some criminal offenses, you follow Chinese law. It was not clear whether this was done in an attempt to cater for the fact that many Chinese inhabitants at that time were still not used to the English law. In fact, no idea at all. The position was clarified by subsequent legislative amendments, Ordinance 6 of 45, I'm talking about 1845, Ordinance 2 of 1846, Ordinance 3 of 1873, and now, or later on, the application of English law ordinance in 1966 this time, over a century later, and also in 1973. It was generally believed that the new provisions of these later ordinances, which adopted different wording, had not changed the legal position. So as a result of these, all these statutes, accumulation of these statutes, the common law system was applied in Hong Kong for the first time. The law of England was to apply unless it was shown to not applicable by reason of local circumstances. What were these local circumstances? We'll see later on. Now, it is beyond question that the common law is well capable of adapting itself to local circumstances, and that the courts would do so instead of strictly applying the common law in appropriate cases. English law was generally considered inapplicable where it related to the specific conditions in England or its application would lead to injustice or oppression. In the case of Wu Hoi Leung and Ku Kong Yong, 1930, a straight settlement case cited by Mr. Drakeman in his report, the Privy Council said, end of quote, "The modification of the law of England could obtain in the colony in the application of that law to the various alien races established there arises from the necessity of preventing the injustice of oppression which would ensue if that law was applied to alien races unmodified." And that was the view expressed in various authorities. So there you are. We have, in the common law, the power of the judge to adapt and modify the English law to cater for local circumstances. Judges are required to decide what was to be applicable and what was to be inapplicable. However, the Secretary of State at that time considered this somewhat unsatisfactory. He was concerned that this might, and I quote, "transfer to the judge a large part of his duties, a large part of the duties of the legislature." That was usurping the function of the legislature. In my view, this worry was misplaced. Under the common law system, the role of judges is to declare what the law is, and it need be to make laws, new law, in appropriate circumstances, in order to do justice to the cases before them. There is no question about that. Thus, for example, the common law was held to be not applicable in cases involving the right to ancient light, the Belilios case, the statute of distribution, the Ho Chi Chung case, and customary adoption, the Wong Choi Ho case, and some of the more important intestate estate cases, and also not forgetting matrimonial cases, the concubines, and their issues. So that's actually the adaptation by the court, the common law, on local circumstances. Now, what about the Chinese law and custom? There was nothing in the statutes about what would the position be if the English law was found to be inapplicable. Was the Chinese law custom abrogated altogether? Or was Chinese law and customs to be applied in such cases, or in a modified form? It is believed that the earlier proclamations had preserved Chinese law and custom. There was no statute which expressly abrogated such laws. And see the cases which I quoted. Now, these authorities were, however, seriously doubted by Mr. Hayden, who argued with great force, in my view, that the court had totally misunderstood the proclamations and entirely misconstrued the subsequent legislation. Notwithstanding, I'll come to that later on, but notwithstanding such strong criticism, these cases had been approved in subsequent cases, and it was never doubted that Chinese law and since then, that Chinese law and custom was part of Hong Kong law. In various cases, in the case of Chek Chiu Hong, the Chief Justice at that time said, in quite a sweeping manner, and without citing any authority in support, he said, "Hong Kong is a colony obtained by cession from China, and consequently the laws of China, as enforced in Hong Kong at that time, remained operative, except such as were contrary to the fundamental principles of the English law. For example, laws permitting torture, slavery, etc., is subject to the right of the Crown to order and change those laws." He quoted Section 5 of the number 3 Ordinance, 1873. That section does not in terms advocate Chinese law, as I said, no sexual touching on it and custom. And presumably these laws, and you also work presumably, these laws and customs would, for the reasons given when the corresponding provisions of Second Three of the 1845 ordinance were being considered, and I look through that ordinance, through those such discussion continue to operate, unless the Chief Justice is bold enough to give these qualifications, which were not in the statutes. So unless A, they had been expressly repealed or modified by legislation, or B, they had been set aside by reason of the operation of a part of the law of England as it existed on the 5th of April 1843, which was not inapplicable to the local circumstances of colony or its inhabitants. Unquote. See also, in the case of OUC number 1, where the court said, quite casually, Chinese law and customs prevail only if the corresponding English law is inapplicable in the sense that it cannot be applied without injustice or oppression, and if it is not shown to be excluded by Hong Kong legislation. But surprisingly, this was adopted and followed in two CFA cases. In the first case is Leung Sai Leung by Herman Judge Chen in 1999, and another one by Lord Millet in the case of Su Toi Li in 2001. Further, Chinese law and custom would easily be regarded as part of the, so that's settled on higher authorities, rightly or wrongly. Further, Chinese law and custom could easily be regarded as part of the local circumstances which the court needed to consider. If the relevant English law was considered not applicable because of local circumstances, it was likely that the situation was governed by Chinese law and customs, which rendered the application of the relevant English law in such circumstances unjust or even oppressive. Whatever misgivings this might have been, it's probably too late now to say that Chinese law and customs were excluded as part of Hong Kong law. I should add that the reminder that there are authorities to the effect that Chinese law and customs must not be applied if it offends the fundamental principles of English law. That, in my view, is probably correct. So Chinese law and custom, like any other law, can be changed by statutes. Legislation subsequently did intervene and had either affirmed or abrogated some of the more commonly applicable Chinese law and customs. For example, we had a series of matrimonial reform legislation in 1971. We have the New Territories Ordinance, section I think 13, deals with the registration of Tom and Joe's, etc., etc. That's pre-1997. What about post-1997? The application of English law ordinance was not adopted as contravening the basic law, and that's the NPC decision on the 23rd February 1997. It was considered no longer necessary in view of Article 8, which preserves the laws previously enforced before the handover, and the English Acts of Parliament in the schedule thereto were clearly not applicable to post-1997 Hong Kong. However, I note, interestingly, Article 8 somehow refers only to, quote, customary law, not Chinese customary law, or Chinese law or custom. Maybe because Hong Kong is now Chinese territory, and it was not seen fit to add Chinese the basic law. In this particular article, it was the basic law. But however, none of the provisions in the basic law, even in the Joint Declaration and even in the various decisions of the NPC, was there any definition of what customary law is. But in my view, since the intention of Article 8 is to preserve previous compatible laws and statutes, there is no reason to doubt that the previous laws do not include Chinese law and custom, which has been regarded as part of Hong Kong law. It must be noted that paragraph 4 of the NPC decision, which I refer to, allows for the modification, adaptation, limitations, and exceptions as are necessary so as to bring the laws previously in force into conformity with the status of Hong Kong after the resumption of sovereignty, as well as to be in conformity with the relevant provisions of Basic Law. This was actually enacted as Section 1A, 1 capital A, of the Chapter 1. This was actually invoked in the Congo case, the famous Congo case, in which the Court of Final Appeal referred certain issues, certain articles of the Basic Law to the NPC for interpretation. In that case, of course, concerned state immunity. But the scope of such provision remains to be considered in future appropriate cases. We have seen how the law adapts or modifies itself to local circumstances, to cultural differences, traditional differences. What about language? In my view, language is one of the most important local circumstances. So how did our system, how did our law cope with the difference in language? The answer is simply, little or nothing had been done for the first 130 years. Since the establishment of the Legislative Council and the Supreme Court in 1843, proceedings in the legal chambers and in the courts were naturally conducted in English, and statutes were enacted, judgments delivered in that language. But the vast majority in Hong Kong could hardly speak English at that time. Interpretation and translation services were thus provided, especially in the courtroom, where personal liberty and property rights were to be protected and pursued. The rights to these services were judicially recognized in the Queen against Kwok Leung and others in 1909, where the full court held that these were essential services to which a defendant facing trial was entitled even when he was legally represented. So even if he had a lawyer, he still had to provide interpretation and translation service. That only mitigated to some extent the harshness and sense of injustice which was felt among the Chinese inhabitants at that time. As the legal historian Professor Christopher Munn commented, and I quote, "In a colony where English law was applied to a largely non-English speaking population, accustomed to its own legal traditions, another attribute of the rule of law came prominently into question. The accessibility, intelligibility, and predictability of the law. From the earliest days, the government attempted to communicate aspects of the law by issuing Chinese proclamation." He was talking about history. "Proclamation of sentences of criminals and summaries of legislation." Mind you, sentences of common criminals and summaries of legislation. The magistrate Hillier helped produce a Chinese language magazine which carried articles explaining the legal system. Surprisingly, a magistrate was helping to produce a Chinese magazine, and it was called Ha Yi Gun Zhan. One of the duties of the Registrar General at that time was to explain laws to Chinese leaders. Very straight up. So how did he do it? I don't know. Supposing he had lunch, dinner with the leaders and tried to explain, oh, this morning some new laws were passed in the Legislative Council, etc., etc. So that was done. In 1862, the government started a Chinese language edition of the Hong Kong Gazette. Although it had a limited impact, Chinese newspapers emerging in the 1860s reported on court cases. In 1873, an editor, Chan Ayi, a former interpreter in the magistracy, offered his service to translate Hong Kong's laws into Chinese. The government declined, not wishing to place such a project in private hands. Unquote. So that was the position for the first 130 years. It's not very certain that the Secretary of State affairs had regrettably continued, and there was growing pressure on the government to implement a new language policy. And to give you an example, in 1841, Hong Kong had only 5,000 inhabitants, or Chinese inhabitants. In the 1970s, we had 4 million, an increase of 800 times, almost. And now, in the 1970s, steps had finally been taken to move towards the bilingual legal system. There are four such steps. First, the official language ordinance, kept filed in 1974, was enacted. Following the recommendations of the Chinese Language Committee appointed by the government, both English and Chinese were declared official languages with equal status, but only for communication between the government and members of the public. Statutes, however, continued to be enacted and published only in English. Proceedings in the Magistrates' Court and tribunals may now be conducted in either of the two official languages. But cases in the district court or above shall still be conducted only in English. Any party or witness may use either English or Chinese or such other language as the court may permit. There were no statistics about the number of cases in the lower courts which were conducted in Chinese in those days. But the impression was that that was only an occasional occurrence. This should not be seen as a reflection on the need for a bilingual court system or the lack of it. This was partly due to the small number of bilingual magistrates at that time, and partly because magistrates and lawyers alike were trained in English and were not used to conducting proceedings in Chinese. They were never keen to do so. Furthermore, the important thing was the law was still entirely in English. The second step was the ordinance was amended in 1987 to enable the government to introduce bilingual legislation, seeing that one of the crux of the matter would be the legislation, the laws, that other than the court judgments. So it started to introduce a bilingual legislation. The law instructions were then amended to allow this to be done. All new legislation shall be enacted in both languages, official languages. Both English and Chinese texts of the ordinance shall be equally authentic and shall be construed accordingly. And that is section 10A(1) of cap 1. And each text is presumed to have the same meaning each authentic text. I shall deal with some conflict and the decisions and court decisions later on. Where there is a difference in meaning, which the ordinary applicable rules of statutory interpretation do not resolve, the meaning which best reconciles the text, having regard to the object and purposes of the ordinance, shall be adopted. This was a big step forward, because without a Chinese version of the statute, our magistrates who dealt with statutory offences most of the time would find it difficult to conduct proceedings in Chinese. Also, in those days, if a court hearing was to be conducted in Chinese, it has to be Chinese all the way and not partly part of the proceeding. So what do we do? So if you conduct a proceeding in Chinese, and when someone refers you to the English statute, what do you do? You can't change. So what do you do? There is no Chinese text. So that was the main reason for having bilingual legislation. It also paved the way for the greater use of Chinese in the higher courts and ultimately a full bilingual legal system. The third step is that as part of the bilingual legislation scheme, government commenced to translate all existing ordinances and subsidiary legislation into Chinese. It's not a small job, because there were then 529 ordinances, and they count the number of pages. How many? 22,000 pages. So this difficult task took a full 10 years to do, and was completed shortly before July 1997. But the Chinese version, however, had taken many more years to synchronize by the plan, the bilingual legislation of the 5G committee, before it became law. The fourth and final step to implement the bilingual court system was that the law was changed yet again in 1995 to enable legal proceedings at all levels of court to be conducted in either of the official languages. Thus, the bilingual court system was put in place in anticipation of a change of sovereignty in July 1997. What's the constitutional position after the handover? Under Article 9 of the Basic Law, in addition to the Chinese language, English may also be used as an official language by the executive authorities, legislature, and judiciary of the Hong Kong SAR. The effect of this article is that not only the laws enacted by the legislature, but also proceedings in court shall be bilingual. Now, the opening words, in addition to Chinese language, have given rise to the argument, in the case of Chen Gailan, that this implies that Chinese takes precedence and that English is only permitted as a second language. In that case, the Chinese speaking defendant contended that he had a right under the Basic Law to a trial conducted in Chinese. So he said, I have a right to have the trial conducted in Chinese, or alternatively, a right to be tried before a bilingual judge. That sounds quorum fishing or shopping. Although he was legally represented, I think, by Mr. Martin Lee. Now, and he asked to be provided. However, it was clear that he would be provided with the interpretation service, even if the trial was to be conducted in English. The trial was, I think, before a monolingual magistrate. Justice Hyman did not find it necessary to make a finding on the precedence of the two languages. He held that the constitutional right of a person to use Chinese in a court of law means no more than the right of that person to employ that language for the purpose of forwarding or protecting his interests, and that right does not imply a reciprocal obligation on the part of the court to use that language. So no right. You have a right to use it. Use it, yourself. But you cannot force upon the court to use that language. The court had a final say. In my view, this must be correct. It was the deliberate design of the 1995 amendments that any party or witness in court proceeding is entitled to use either of the official languages, indeed any language, Russian, French, whatever, of his own choice, with the assistance of the appropriate interpretation. But judges, magistrates, and lawyers can only choose either Chinese or English. Why is the difference? This is because the court has a duty to keep the record of the proceedings, including the judge, in either of the official languages. And lawyers have a duty to assist the court and try to pursue their client's rights in the language adopted by the court. While each participant may choose the language he is more comfortable with, it is for the court to decide on its own working language in any particular case, taking into consideration all relevant factors. The question as to which of the two languages takes precedence does not arise for consideration in relation to entitlement to use the language. But this would only need to be resolved in the case of discrepancy in the meaning of Chinese and English text of the legislation to be construed. So when this arises, the court shall resort to Section 10, Capital B of Chapter 1 for guidance. By way of contrast, as a matter of interest, in case of discrepancy in the two texts of the basic law, not ordinary legislation, in the basic law, the Standing Committee of the MPC had decided that the Chinese text shall remain. So there's a major difference. Now there is, how do we apply? What is the discretion of the court? There is no hard and fast rule as to how the court's discretion is to be exercised when deciding which language to use. A flexible and pragmatic approach is adopted, bearing in mind the rights of the parties to a fair trial and the principle that justice must not only be done, but must also be seen to be done. The paramount consideration is a just and expeditious disposal of the case. In 1998, a guideline was issued to all judges and judicial officers. They were reminded that it is the right of the parties and the lawyers to choose which language to use, and that the court should not pressurize or encourage or be seen to pressurize or encourage any person to use any language other than the one chosen by that person. The court will consider a matter such as the language ability of the parties, the lawyers and the judge, the wishes of the parties, including the right to instruct the lawyer of their own choice. So for example, if he chooses a lawyer who can only speak English, then I think most probably the court will accommodate, because the court, judge or magistrate, understands English, speaks English. So in this case, certain sense, he probably would conduct the proceedings in English. To read the language in which the witness will testify, how many witnesses, maybe if all witnesses will testify in Chinese, then maybe it's a good case for using Chinese in the proceedings. The volume of documents could maybe be required to be translated, and the factual and legal issues in dispute. I think that is also a very important factor. Supposing the case involves a very difficult English principle, but then perhaps it would be unsuitable to conduct proceedings in Chinese, even if the parties are in Chinese, and even if the lawyers and the judge can argue the case in Chinese. How does the present system work in practice? Very briefly, there are disadvantages in conducting court proceedings in the same language as that of the parties, and this group first, who dispense with the need for translation and interpretation, save a lot of time and cost, avoid the risk of inaccurate interpretation, enable direct communication between the court and the parties and witnesses, and inspire greater confidence in our system. In practice, the choice of language will be ascertained by the judge or magistrate at the listening hearing, and the parties will be consulted. And having considered all circumstances and the guideline, he would initially, decide which language will be used by the court at the hearing, and the parties would act accordingly. For example, having documents translated, instructing a bilingual lawyer or monolingual lawyer who speaks their language, and prepare certified translations. The language thus chosen may of course be changed for good reason subsequently, subject to the approval of the court. But the decision of the court is final. We're talking about the language of the court, the legal proceedings. It simply doesn't mean you will speak only in that language. You can speak whatever language you like, with the assistance of interpretation. Now, whatever language the court uses, the parties and the witnesses will use the language they feel more comfortable with. Interpretation service would be provided if necessary. Lawyers will usually address the court in the same language as that used by the court. I pause here to say that no advocate would like to seek to persuade court in a different language through an interpreter. That's not advocacy, that is simply translation. Where a proceeding is conducted in one of the official languages, this is the language of a court in that case. This means that the judge will speak in that language, direct the jury in that language, and writes his judgment or verdict in that language. The transcript of the proceedings will also be kept in that language. The parties cannot insist on having our proceedings protected in their own language. Hearings on appeal. Usually an appeal is conducted in the same language as that used in the lower court. Sometimes, however, an appellant may like to instruct different lawyers who may wish to conduct the appeal in the other official languages, in view of the issues involved in the appeal. For example, there may not be very many legal issues in the trial, but when it goes to appeal, then perhaps your lawyer may like to take a difficult legal issue. Then what do you do? You can apply to have the appeal heard in the other language, in English. At other times, an appellant who was legally represented at the trial may also, may for whatever reason, wish to conduct the appeal on his own, and in the other official language used by the court. When the appropriate occasion arises, the appeal court may allow a change from one official language to the other at the hearing. In deciding to do so or not, the appeal court will take into consideration a number of factors: language used in the lower court, the amount of transcript to be translated, the urgency of the appeal, because if it takes a long time to translate, and the defendant may be languishing in the prison, so what do? Forget about translation, use some other language. Whether the appellant is in custody and the length of his sentence, the issues involved in the appeal, whether any difficult point of law, and whether the appellant will be legally represented or not. Now, as I mentioned just now, this practice has given rise to apparently conflicting court decisions. In the case of Wan Chiu Ying in 1999, in declining a last-minute request to conduct the appeal in English, the court review said, and I quote, "The parties concerned must appreciate that if the hearing of the case has been fixed to be conducted in Chinese, it must be," the court used the word "must be," "conducted in Chinese, unless there are special reasons for not doing so. The fact that an appeal is fixed before bilingual judges does not mean that the appeal can be conducted in English. For the sake of clarity, this court will notify the officers in charge of fixing dates that in future, when dates are fixed for cases conducted in Chinese in the court below, it must be specified that the appeal will be heard in Chinese." Probably going a bit too far, but as I said, it was decided in the circumstances of the case. In the case of Li Shen On, again, the court appeal said, "If the hearing of a case is conducted in Chinese and all documentary exhibits, evidence, statements, notices of application, as well as reasons for the conviction and sentence are written in Chinese, this court will not draw on substantial manpower resources and public funds to provide translation service to facilitate counsel who can only speak English in conducting the appeal on behalf of the appellant on parallel occasions." As I said, probably the court did not go as far as that, but on the face of it, these two judgments seemed to suggest that, sorry, if you have a Chinese trial in the lower court, you have to stick by it, no change. Going too far, maybe. However, these cases were dealt with in the subsequent case only one. In that case, the trial was conducted in Chinese, but on appeal, counsel asked to address the court in English, but to refer to the transcript in Chinese. Strange. He obviously was a bilingual lawyer. He wanted to address the court in English, but because the trial was conducted in Chinese in the court below, he wanted to refer to transcript Chinese without translating it into English. That was allowed. And the Vice President Tan remarked at the end of the judgment, "Insofar as these cases, which I mentioned before, the two cases, could be read as indicating that legal representatives might not be allowed to choose either or both official languages at the hearing of the appeal, they cannot stand with Section 5 and should be disregarded." To conflicting decision of the Court of Appeal. on a procedural matter, which unfortunately may affect the rights of the parties. He's, in my view, I do not think one, Xu Ying or Li Xuan, decided that the appeal from a case which was conducted in Chinese must necessarily be heard in Chinese, notwithstanding the wording on the face of it. In one, the trial was conducted in Chinese. The judge wrote his decision in Chinese. The notice of appeal was prepared in Chinese. Counsel of the parties were bilingual, that was capable of speaking Chinese. The appeal was fixed for him in Chinese, and the written submissions were prepared in Chinese. Yet, only a few days before the hearing, counsel requested for the appeal to be conducted in English on the ground that she would refer to English authorities. That could not be regarded as a good enough reason for the change, and the court rightly rejected that request. So you can see, in the facts of this, on the facts of that case, there was amply good reason for refusing that. Maybe the court went too far in rejecting. Maybe the court was actually annoyed. Everything is Chinese. Why in a few days before the hearing you want to switch channel, so to speak? Because you want to refer to English authorities. We can hear you referring by all means. Similarly, in the Li Xuan case, the court was legitimately concerned that undue delay might be caused and great public expense might have been incurred simply because the applicant chose to instruct a different, but also monolingual counsel to conduct the trial after the appeal. Jury trials. Jury trials bring into the judicial process ordinary men and women with their common sense, knowledge, and life experience. When court proceedings were conducted only in English, there were practical limitations in having eligible or qualified jurors who might have sufficient proficiency in the English language to understand the evidence given in court, the submissions made by counsel, and more importantly, the directions given by the judge. This had posed a problem for a largely non-English speaking population. In the past, only people who had a higher standard of education were considered as having the necessary language proficiency and so qualified for jury service. In those days, Form 5 or Form 7 were considered as high enough education, and students, graduates of Form 5 or Form 6 were considered as having sufficient English proficiency to be a juror. Nowadays, you will shake your hand at. The number of qualified jurors were thus, in those days, understandably small. The result was that jury trials were rightly or wrongly considered trials not exactly by one's peers, but by one's educated peers. However, for over a century, this arrangement had been accepted by the legal profession and the judiciary as working well. So after the law was changed to enable jury trials to be conducted in Chinese after 1997, the question arose as to whether the education standard for jurors should be lowered. After much deliberation, it was decided to retain the present arrangements for fear of creating two categories of jurors, one for English trials, one for Chinese trials. Those for the English trials may have a higher standard, and those for Chinese trials may have a lower standard of education. So where do we stand? And this may give rise to the impression of a difference in standards, and this will give rise to injustice. And this will also give rise to the possibility of shopping. Maybe I want a more sensible jury, and then maybe I want an English trial. And for example, if it is a case of drug by someone who is less educated, then maybe I want some a man on the street rather than someone who is a law graduate, something like that. Now, to prepare for Chinese jury trials, the judiciary had translated the specimen jury directions for reference by trial judges. It is now on the website. How do we resolve discrepancies between two texts, the Chinese and the English text? Discrepancies between these two texts have also been subject of conflicting judicial decisions. In Tang Yuk Ha, the proprietress of a fresh provision shop was convicted under Bylaw 35 of the Food Business Urban Council Bylaw for having placed a metal tray of fresh fish and a chopping block and a table outside her shop. The question was whether this amounted to an addition or an alteration which would result in a material deviation from the approved plan. If so, this would be an extension of the shop, resulting in a material variation from the approved plan, and she should be convicted. The judge considered that this construction violated the words used in Chinese language, Chinese version. He held that the two texts could not be reconciled, even under Section 10b, and that, and I quote, "the only reasonable step for the court to take is to give effect to the text which favors the appellant." Chen, in his matter of principle, probably nothing wrong with it. However, this was not followed in the case of Lao San Qing in 2002, which dealt with the offense of causing an obstruction in a public place. In the English text, the crucial words were "doing an act whereby obstruction may accrue to a public place." But in the Chinese text, the wording referred to a situation where obstruction had already occurred. The judge, relying on what Justice Peter Cheung said in the Chan Fung Lan case, held that the English version, which existed in 1932, long before the Chinese text was translated, came into being, should take precedent. So in terms of time, which came first, should take precedent. In my view, the court, in construing a statutory provision, is to ascertain its meaning according to the language as expressed, and must have regard to the context and purpose of the legislation, which includes, of course, the legislative history. But no doubt, the interest and fairness to the accused should also be taken into consideration. But that is only one factor, albeit probably the most important factor. Now, this approach will give greater effect to the illustrative purpose as required by this law. And Chinese texts, interesting enough, the Chinese text of Bylaw 35 were later amended to accord with the English text. So in other words, the government found perhaps the Chinese version was incorrect. There were two special features of our present bilingual court system. First, the court gives no definition, the audience gives no definition of the official spoken Chinese language. And it's well known, there is only one written Chinese language. But the spoken language in Hong Kong is either Putonghua or Cantonese. Thus, Cantonese is the dialect most often used in court proceedings in Hong Kong. Secondly, the ordinance enables either English and Chinese to be used in whole or any part of the court proceedings. And this means that the court can conduct the proceedings partly in Chinese and partly in English, if the circumstances are simply required. This happens when, for example, an expert witness who does not speak the language used by the court is called to give evidence, or when the lawyers may wish to make their submissions in English, although the evidence is in Chinese. Sometimes the judge may like to write his judgment in English, even though the proceeding will conduct it in Chinese. If he finds it easier to express the legal language involved in the case in English, so be it. So that's the special features. I now come to a number of difficulties encountered in developing a bilingual court system. I have, at the moment, about 7, but there may be more. First, improper use of the bilingual procedure. There have been complaints that by parties and lawyers, the magistrates or even judges had pressurized or given the impression of pressurizing the parties and their lawyers to conduct proceedings in Chinese, which is forbidden by the guideline. On the other hand, some parties or their lawyers have been seen to have abused the procedure by making last-minute requests to change the language to be used at the hearing. For example, this would save them translating some of the documents. Maybe they want to instruct somebody else. Sometimes the judge may like to write his judgments, but this might have been done with the intention to delay the proceedings or to engage on shopping. The second difficulty is the suspicion of favoring the unrepresented litigant or party. Since the parties and the witnesses can now directly communicate with the court, there is an increase in the number of unrepresented cases. This requires greater care and attention on the part of the magistrate or the judge, who has to explain the procedure and the issues to them. This not only takes more time for the hearing, but also gives rise to the suspicion on the part of the other party or the lawyers that the court is unduly favorable to litigants in person, to the disadvantage of the represented. Third difficulty is the reduced respect and confidence for the law and the system. Some parties, witnesses, lawyers, or even the court have been heard to have used terms and language which are regarded as vulgar, indecent, and quite unacceptable. And some blame the Cantonese dialect because they say in Hong Kong, when you use Chinese dialect, you are actually sometimes, you can sometimes be quite vulgar or indecent because of some slangs. Now this will reduce the solemnity of the proceedings and lower the dignity of the court. All this will have an adverse impact on the respect and competence which the court deserves and which the public may have for the administration of justice. The fourth difficulty is the lack of legal material, which was probably one of the more important difficulties. In a speech delivered at the Hong Kong Union in 2011, Madam Justice Kwan expressed concern with the lack of legal material as an obstruction for the development of Chinese jurisprudence. I tend to agree. This is a legitimate concern. Legal materials, including legal textbooks, case law, and articles published in Chinese language, are necessary for reference or citation in making submissions or for writing judgments. Legal concepts and principles are discussed in submissions and explained and expanded by judges in their language. After all, English common law is in English and is developed in English. Some of these concepts and principles cannot easily be expressed or formulated in simple language or with precision. The fifth difficulty is the standard of Chinese. The unsatisfactory standard of some of the judges and lawyers is also a cause for concern. There is a misconception that a person whose mother tongue is Chinese would have no problem in presenting arguments or writing submissions or judgments in Chinese. That simply is not the case. Special and continuous training in such skills is required, and experience in using Chinese, both orally and in writing, is indispensable. The sixth difficulty is the standard of translation. This is somewhat also, sometimes also worrying. This can be reflected from the translation of some of the transcripts and the judgments for use in the higher courts. With the lack of sufficiently high quality materials, judges and lawyers who with standard of English or standard of Chinese is not so high, he find it even more onerous to do research, exhibitions, or write judgments. Finally, the seventh difficulty is the difficulties in translation. I mentioned it briefly. The difficulties in translating legal materials into Chinese cannot be underestimated. The two languages are so radically different that they hardly share any similarity at all, particularly in the area of law. Secondly, many statutory provisions are already not easy to express, even in English, even more, and more difficult to explain in another language. Thirdly, there are concepts in the English common law could still have any equivalent in Chinese. I venture to suggest, perhaps, in future, simple language should be used when drafting legislation, whether in the English or Chinese language, whichever comes first, so that it is easier to read, to understand, and to translate. Now, all these are problems which can be solved, which are not easy to solve. Nor can I offer any quick solution. However, I should think that we need to do much more on at least three areas. First, the training of bilingual lawyers and judges. And then the building of more Chinese jurisprudence. And finally, the education of the public. Finally, I probably have spent too much time long enough. Finally, I will conclude. Where do we go from now? The bilingual legal system is not only a legal requirement and a political necessity. It is also a social need. For how can the rights guaranteed under the basic law be protected if one has difficulty even understanding law or in having access to the law? A bilingual court system is not a bilingual legal system. It's only an essential component of that system. And also, a bilingual court system is not an end in itself. A workable bilingual court system is necessary for the administration of justice. It also facilitates the development of a credible and reputable bilingual legal system. But the fact remains, as I mentioned, the common law is and is developed in English. I venture to ask, how much can a bilingual court system help trace the development of common law in Hong Kong legal system? I'm not denying the value of the bilingual court system, but I'm simply asking how much value we do not know. The common law has been able to cope with local circumstances and has enriched itself. Can our system now cope with the language differences without making a wrong turn in the development of the law? Do we want to keep to the mainstream of the common law? Or do we want to develop the common law with Hong Kong characteristics? How would our Chinese jurisprudence be quoted in overseas jurisdictions? In which direction should we move forward from now on? Bilingualism in the law is a culture which has to be created, to be developed, and to mature. How do we go about doing this? Or rather, what do we want to do? It may be time, high time, for us to consider the way forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Justice Chan. May we now invite Justice Chan and Professor Chan to the stage for the dialogue and Q&A section. Justice Chan and Professor Chan, please.
Well, let me first thank Mr. Chan for such a comprehensive and inspiring lectures, which took us over 180 years of development within an hour. If I may just pick up from the last point, and which is indeed the first question I have when I come to this lecture, is given that our common law is rooted in English. Now, a quarter of a century has passed since we introduced the bilingual legal system in 1989. What we have seen now is 90% of the trial at the magistrate level and lower court level are now conducted in Chinese. The reverse is true at the Court of Appeal or Court of Final Appeal. So, as long as we link to the common law, do we have to settle that Chinese will have to be a secondary language or in a more inferior language? Because as you point out at the very last point is, very few people outside Hong Kong in the common law jurisdiction will be able to cite the Chinese law. And perhaps to some extent that may be true with the Canadian bilingual system as well. All the Canadian Supreme Court judgments are translated into English and French. But in the common law world, very few people refer to the French judgments. We all refer to the English judgments only. But a lot of efforts have been put in, translation and so on. Are that effort worth spending, or could a bilingual legal system has to be justified or by some other reason?
My personal view is that language is only a tool and not an end in itself. Language is to facilitate the administration of justice. Now, we have to live with the fact that the common law is in English. As I emphasized probably two or three times in the last hour, it's developed in English. Now, in that case, if we do not want to be sidetracked, then our jurisprudence should, in the first place, be written in English. We have to keep to the mainstream. We cannot afford to be sidelined. We cannot afford to be laughed at by the common law jurisdictions or around the world. But having said that, I can see that if the majority of the population in Hong Kong are Chinese speaking, then in order to serve, in order to do justice to the pursuit for rights or personal liberty, then I think we have to adopt the means to ensure that justice is done to their cases. And therefore, I tend to agree that perhaps a very cruel fact of life is that maybe when we come to the common law, Chinese is probably a secondary language. That's something which we cannot avoid concluding.
Every now and then I've heard students coming to me, particular students who are trained overseas or who study overseas when they are not confident about their Chinese language proficiency. And they ask me, is there a future for them to join the bar? Particularly now, if they have to practice in the lower court, and you can't really practice in the lower court without knowing the Chinese language now. And at the same time, I've heard also other students, even working in the corporate commercial field, is that these days IPO or documentation are done in Chinese, except that they are done in simplified Chinese, and then you translate in English for the other client, but your main client want it to be in Chinese. How would this affect particularly young people like Stevens, who are going to join the legal professions? How do you see this bilingual legal development and as a potential role?
I think what I've been talking about was actually judgments and jurisprudence for external consumption. But there is also the very important element of internal requirements. You've got to serve, the first thing for a lawyer like Stephen or anybody else, on any graduates from this faculty, will be to serve the public in Hong Kong. And therefore, what is required of you? Only the Chinese. It's suicide. In other words, if you are not conversant with contract law, for example, don't get near contract cases. If you are not conversant with Chinese language, in other words, you cannot serve Chinese clients. You cannot serve in areas where Chinese citizens are clients. So there are the two elements. You know, not new system. What do you want to do? I asked a number of questions. I may not have the correct answer. I may not have the answers at all. But I'm thinking about the two different aspects. They are not the same side of it. They are not the two sides of the same coin. Of course, you want to have a credible and reputable legal system in Hong Kong so that your jurisprudence can be cited, can be adopted, can be followed overseas. Yes, of course, you can want to do that. But to do that, I think the better way is to do it in English, as simple as that. But on the other hand, if you want to serve, I think the majority of our veterans, the majority of our lawyers, would be required to serve the population in Hong Kong or maybe people across the border. In that case, I think there is a larger reservoir of cases for people to take on. So in other words, I don't think there would be any disadvantage. You see, if you're not conversing with IPO cases, forget it. You do something else. You don't serve your meaning client. It's simple as that. But I think that, you know, the legal system in Hong Kong is not only the duty of implementing a legal, bilingual legal system. It does not lie only on the tradition. So it only deals with the court system. So I think it's wrong to assume that the courts, the tradition, can do everything to reinvent a bilingual legal system. I think that's why I say we learn the educational public, Chinese students, and also the lawyers, because they are the people who will serve the public with the knowledge of the law and the traditional Chinese side of the law. That's all.
Stephen, what do you think?
Just now, Professor Chen mentioned a point from the perspective of a petitioner. But I would also like to know from a perspective as a judge, Justice Chen, do you have any experience that is related to the adaptation of common law to the Hong Kong context? And an experience that is related to that, and an experience that you find it really memorable or even interesting?
Well, I have been out of action with implications in respect of trials or hearings in Chinese, because in court of final appeal, we very seldom have Chinese appeals. The best you can get is actually the application for the to appeal, and many of them were actually prepared in Chinese. So I would be the person responsible for screening all these. There's nothing very interesting about these cases. But one of the more interesting experiences is actually, could I mention is actually the translation of the specimen jury directions. It was in 1997. The law was changed in 1995. And I was in charge of implementing it. So I started off looking around for whatever, look at the court form, if it is Chinese, if it is English, if it is Chinese, I go for termination. But then I realized, in fact, I want to start the jury trial. So I look at the certain directions, because of course, you can actually direct jury in whatever you like, in a way, whatever suits you. But there are specimen directions which you would have to make reference to. So what do you do? So I had started the exercise of translating such certain directions. Now, as judges, I mean, obviously, I cannot do the translation myself. I'm spending a long, long time doing it. What I did was actually send it to the interpretation translation service. They come back, and usually they are indecipherable. You can't understand. You actually don't understand what was actually translated. So what do I do? So what I did was actually I handpicked quite a number of bilingual judges, and from no time is where to try cases, and we either do it after work during our holidays or till lunchtime. So we decided to do our lunchtime session. So what happened was actually we have a huge chunk of translation of its written directions, and quite a number of judges sat together over lunch. We had sandwiches for a number of weeks, you know. Not days, a number of weeks, you know. Every day, every lunch, we had sandwiches, and we actually screened, we actually vetted the translation offered by the translation service. So there you are. We cannot say that they are perfect. However, it's actually understandable. Because when the product, initial product came to us, it could not be used. So that was the one thing. But having actually finished translating and vetting the certain directions, we were actually ready to start doing trials even before 1997. Now, Acting Chief Justice was Acting Justice Power, and I pressed for the starting of jury trials, because I wanted to have a go at it first before the handover, and I have actually made some of the colleagues conversant with these certain directions, etc. The acting Chief Justice was rather worried, but he had no answer to my request. So I remember that he summoned a meeting of judges. So there were about 30 of us, High Court judges, sitting together. High Court and Court of Appeal judges sitting together. And they were discussing this possibility of Chinese jury trial. Before. So I said, "Are you ready?" He said, "You are not." So I said, "Why not?" So I mean, quite an interesting discussion at the judges' meeting. So finally, of course, as the acting chief justice, his last word prevailed. So we couldn't start the jury trial even before. We were ready. Quite a number of our Chinese colleagues were actually bouncing up and down. Because they imagined some of these specific directions, for example, murder, for example, rape. They were those who actually screened the translation. So he said, "We're ready. I can do it." So I don't know. So that's the interesting thing about it. Another interesting experience was actually the Congo case. You know now that in fact there was a majority, 3-2. But that's beside the point. What happened was, in fact, the first judgment decided to refer some issues to the NPC for interpretation. But that's a very sensitive issue. It's a very sensitive matter. So we could not allow the matter to go public. So it's kept confidential. But we need to translate the judgment, because the judgment, together with the questions, would have to be submitted to the NPC. And you simply cannot assume the NPC would understand our judgment in English, 200 pages. So, on the one hand, we have to be confidential. On the other hand, we have to do the translation. So what do? We asked the three translator, very senior translators, to go to the CFA, and I was in charge. So I said, oh, don't go away, stay in the CFA. And you can't finish, you go home, believing everything in the CFA. And in fact, they've done it. The three of them have worked full time to translate the Congo judgments. The three judgments, the major judgment, majority judgment, and two dissenting judgments. And the, I mean, 200 pages. So the three interpreters, translators, guess how many days they needed? Almost 6 weeks. They were very annoyed, they were very bored, you know, because time, day in, day out, they had to do it, nothing else. So they were about five to six weeks, you know, all three of them. So when they finished, that's my problem. Who is going to vet this translation product? I look at them, look at the translations. And I say, oh my God. If they were to be submitted to the NPC, they will not do anything. There will be one country, one system. Nobody will understand. Not understand because one, some of the translations, I mean, I'm not saying that they were no good at all, but they did their best. But, I mean, very difficult to understand judgment already, let alone for them to translate them. So they did their best, simply because they were not conversant with the facts of the case, the legal issues, and whatever they did, they simply put a lot of defects, mistakes. So what do I do? I said, what do you want me to do? So I spoke to the Chief Justice. I said, what's your suggestion? I said, can you, I said, personal request, can you put me off the list? I don't want to try the pieces for the next period of time. So if there are appeals, somebody has to do it. And he was scratching his head. Nowadays we have fewer non-permanent judges than in, I think, was it 2006, 2003, I can't remember, 2006. So if I'm off the list, then it's very difficult to get an MPJ to take my place in a set of cases. So but somehow he did. Probably has the justice little. Who had to fly all the way from Australia. So he spent a few weeks in Hong Kong taking over my cases. So what did I do? Full-time vetter of this judgment. I spent 3 solid weeks doing nothing else. Doing absolutely nothing else. And so that was the memorable experience with our head. And there you are. The first reference to the NPC, and it was done without any hiccup. And I'm not claiming credit, but it was a difficult job. And it was 3 solid full-time weeks. So it was tremendous. And I'll give you one example, Steve. How do you translate with respect? I agree. How do you translate it? I can't remember. I made some corrections at the time. But if you ask me, I forgot. There was, I think, Justice Bokhary said, with respect, I agree. And came up with some very strange translation. It's simple. NPC wouldn't bother whether it's I respect, I agree, or with respect, I disagree, or with no respect, I agree. They probably don't know. But when they read it, you could make sense. How do you translate respect? I can't remember. I've got to look it up. Maybe try to look it up. So that's why I can see that a common law, common, a, a bilingual court system is not easy to administer. But fair enough. I mean, people have been doing it, trying very hard to do it, and I think it's a workable bilingual court system so far. But then, that's why I'm trying to take one further step. What now? What do we want to do further? We're not really doing a court system. We are one. We want to implement a legal system. And the court system is only one component. So the more difficulty we have here.
That ties in also with Patrick's earlier point. Language is about culture. The last example is a good example. With respect, I agree. This is culture. Another thing which we lawyers say all the time in court, if it please you, my lord. How do you translate in Chinese? What does that mean? May it please you, my lord, and so on. It also brings back a fond memory when we translate the Nkaling case. The difference with Congo is Congo has not been published. Nkaling has already been published, the first right of a boat case, and generate a lot of anxiety. So we try to provide an official Chinese translation for that. And there were four of us, the three judges plus myself, and we spent 4 weeks and going over the translation and so on. And never have I read any single judgment, line by line, word by word, and it takes 4 weeks to do that. So let's open the floor to anyone. Yes.
European courts are multilingual, so it must be possible. And actually, everything in the European Union, everything is translated to all the languages of the members. So I think it was 25. Now, you mentioned the advocacy. The lawyer probably like to speak a language that he's good at, and also that the judge will feel sympathetic to that. But advocacy may be tied to rhetoric, and rhetoric may be language specific. But maybe I'm optimistic, but I like to believe that law is independent of language. That, well, as Wittgenstein put it, everything that can be said clearly. So you can put it clear, and the points of law can be made independent of the language. One thing more about the European legal system is that it's a bit more than an adversarial system. There is also the institution of an advocate general, which actually represent a societal situation, which is really different, because otherwise it would be incumbent on the judge to put in on the societal aspects. And then of course there's always, as you say, whether the judge is siding with an unrepresented side, or whether actually the judge is actually putting up the societal case. But with that, perhaps that will actually lead me to take the liberty to ask a question which is actually will take us beyond language. The strength of common law is its ability to evolve with society. So common law must be relevant to the society. Now, at the time of reversion of sovereignty, it become no longer British common law practice in the colony of Hong Kong, but it is common law in Hong Kong, China. So that is a rather abrupt change. I think, I'd like to see what you think. I think the law has not evolved accordingly, and it is rather difficult in the in the evolution of the law to take into account to a very abrupt change. And I think the law has not done so very well. I put it to Elsie and Minsky, but then they always say, well, it's up to the judges, up to the court, and then the court is very happy surface whether the occasion will arise. So I would like to hear it from this side. But you see, for instance, give an example. Before the handover, it seems that the courts are more inclined to fine for the employers. Now, after the handover, it seems to be more inclined to fine for the employees. And some people surmise, or perhaps that the judges now thought that, well, they used to be the masters. Now they are not, they're just sort of under contract. And then the big joke, of course, is that before the handover, if you are sued by your domestic helper, you probably get off. Now, if you're sued by your domestic helper for whatever, you might be in for trouble. And then, now we even have this very big case of a very eminent judge saying that the judges don't have a master. Now, in anywhere in the world, any judge who said no, that their master is the country, because the law comes from the country. So actually, the law is everything comes from the basic law, and in fact, even the application of the common law arises from Article 8 of the basic law. So there's no such thing as a law which already exists in a vacuum. It has to come from the country. So and everybody knows, every judge, you ask a judge in any country, maybe he will say that his employer or his master or employer, so to be, is the country, is the state. But there are judges who say that they have no master. Now, this is clearly, in my opinion, a misunderstanding, a very grave misunderstanding. Because the common law does not exist. I mean, previously, it goes to the Privy Council. This is London. But now, it is the common law as is practiced in Hong Kong, China. So it comes from the country. Well, maybe this is a bit much for you already.
The short answer is that as a judge, we will forget in trying every case, we forget who is the master or who is the servant. We simply do our case. We try the case, evidence, we look at the law, and we apply the law to effect. So, I mean, who is our master? Does not answer, does not actually enter into the picture. So, that's how judges operate. But come back a little bit to what you said. That's why I was thinking about the local circumstances. When I started, I was wondering, the common law for the last 100-something years has been able to cope with differences in culture and in tradition. Why is it that at the moment we have such difficulty in coping with the most important local circumstances, that's language? And that's why I started to look at all the Chinese culture. Well, I mean, but I found out, you know, there were some interesting arguments on whether, in fact, Chinese law and custom has become normal, but that's beside the point. But there you are. I have looked at it as a continuum. The common law is evolving. Common law is developing all the time. And how do you do it? How do you express it in English? When you express it in Chinese, then it's actually to serve the people don't understand language. That's the role of the bilingual court. But what about the bilingual legal system? So that's why I look at it at the wider perspective. What do we do? Who do we serve? What role do we make? Do we make some wrong law in Chinese? You see, I can see the difficulty. It's because it's what is this? You see, when you look at, for example, racist law, you probably heard about it, some of that. Now, if I try the case in Chinese, how would I put it? And there was some discussion. The danger is that when I write my Chinese judgment concerning this important doctrine, and if I find myself out of words, if I cannot express it in Chinese, then what I do? That there is every temptation that I sort of, you know, try to avoid this and that expression. But if I try to do that, then there is also the risk of distorting the principle. When I talk about equity, for example, some doctrine of equity, trust. If I try to express it in a way I want, then there is always a fear that I have expressed it in Chinese incorrectly. That's one area of danger. The other danger is actually, all right, what's the next step? Next step is someone in the translation room translates it. And he may completely misunderstand what I say in Chinese, because when he translates it into English, he may not understand. That's why when I wrote my Chinese judgment, it was a short judgment, probably a medium-sized judgment. If I wrote it in Chinese, I would do the translation myself. I would immediately do it, and I would hand down both versions. I would not wait until the translator to do it for me, because I know there could be mishaps. So there you are, you have two risks. If you try to try the case in Chinese involving a legal point, the two risks. The judge may not be able to fully express it, even to develop it. The second is the translator will do it. And that's why I have insisted, and I think the two chief justices accepted my point. And that is, for every translated judgment, I want some legally qualified person to get it. I won't let another translator do it, because translators know translation. They do not know legal principles. Lawyers know legal principles, but they don't know translation. How do I marry the two? So what I do is I ask translation to give me a product. And if I can manage to have a judge look at it, so much better. But if I have no judge or no judge at the time, and give it to a lawyer. At least we can minimize the inadequacy. To me, translation, the first criteria of translated judgments is accuracy. You cannot afford, or try at least you minimize inadequacy. That's most important. But can I just mention one thing? Completely different matter. So I remember I spent some time to think of a translation for a court. In the magistracy, you call the magistracy, in those days, you call the magistracy your worship, sir or madam. And in the district court, you call the judge his honor. And in the high court or above, you call him your lordship, my lord, right? So how do you do it? Do we have three translations? So I scratch my head, you know, and I discuss with one lawyer, I mean judges. I discuss it with the translator of translation office. I come up with one unitary translation. Fakulgoa is my baby. Because I thought hard, long and hard. I couldn't find, and I think it would be indignified to have three translations. To have done, mean you call a magistrate what? Ah, sir. This is so, you know. And you could, what about madam? Supposing it's a female magistrate. Magistrate, you know, a district judge. Your Honor, say, what do you mean? So, I thought a neutral translation, applicable across the board. Every judicial officer will be called from 1997, I couldn't go on. That's it. And fortunately, the Chief Justice Lee accepted my translation. That's it. So, it's not an easy game. It's not an easy game. But fortunately, and I think I'm happy to say, at the moment, notwithstanding some of the difficulties that I mentioned, the legal court system will be working all right.
Just to add one more point, even more difficult with all the nuances of language, when you say with respect my learned friend, all you mean is he's an idiot. How can you translate that, and so on. But back to the point is, I think generally, of course, law has to adapt to local circumstances and culture. That may have nothing to do with language. Typical example, the law of defamation. What constitutes defamation in England would be very different from Hong Kong. So when you apply the law of defamation, of course, you have to take into account local culture, local context. I think there's no dispute or controversy about that. The other point is, I don't think it's fair to simply to say that if the court finds for the employee, then the court is pro-employee after 1997 and vice versa in 1990, before 1997. The more important thing is to look at the reason of the court. And there may be good reason, there may be factual circumstances which justify the reason. And when it's rule of law is, we expect the court to decide according to the law and not according to the result. And it would be dangerous, and indeed there was a danger in the last couple of years when the court decided something in favor of, say, very generally, the pan-democrat or fight for rights, then we say that it's a liberal court. And as soon as they decide something against that, they say that this is conservative, etc. That seems to be a wrong approach. The proper approach should be the reasoning of the court, and let's criticize the reasoning rather than by labeling. And the last point, I think, I have vague recollection that the statement that judges don't have a master probably is said by the former Chief Justice, Andrew Lee, but that was said in the context of independence of the judiciary, and what I think it means is, although judges are appointed by the government or the chief executive, judges will not take order from them. Judges will not decide the case according to what the government or the chief executive want, but they rather decide the case according to law. I think that is the context of that statement.
As we are approaching the end of this section, can we have one final question from a student?
Lesson that we can learn from Singapore. Say they have one formal language called a formal court language such as English, but they have four different official language. And it seems that the our system is basing on the assumption that Chinese, using Chinese in court will be a better tools in facilitating the administration of justice. But if Singapore can do it, is there anything that we can do to learn from them, that like using English can also be as good as using
English. So at least for the time being, two different societies, completely different societies. Another short answer is, it's politically incorrect in Hong Kong to use English as the only legal language. You see what I mean? You simply cannot in China, except some foreign language. The Chinese, in fact, had accepted the Court of Final Appeal as the final court. That probably as far as they would like to yield. That's all. The other thing was actually the conditions of society. In Hong Kong, 95 or more percent Chinese, speaking Chinese. You look at Singapore, how many percentage of Chinese? What are the Indian? Quite mixed. Although probably Chinese population is in probably more majority. But there are sort of, 40%, 20%, 30%, something like this, you see. So it's completely different. Thirdly, it also depends on the level of education. In Hong Kong, what do you do? What do you teach? Well, we have some like we teach English, second language. But in school, in Singapore, I don't know. Maybe the first language is English. So if the first language is English, then there's nothing wrong to use that language as the language of the law and the language of the court. Whereas in Hong Kong, the mother tongue is actually Chinese. So as I said, it's a political necessity, it's a legal requirement, and it's also a social need. I thought about it, Singapore. If I were given a free choice, probably, we have one single language. They can do it because of the differences in. And that's why I keep going back. There are local differences in local circumstances. The more difficult is actually language, because you do it every day. Culture and tradition, you may not conduct yourself according to certain traditions every day. The language you use every day, right? The tradition may not affect your rights, but if you go to court, you're bound to be involved in arguments on your rights, on your liability, and etc. So the two cannot be put together. So I start to have actually a common thread, but in fact it's probably very difficult to find a common thread. Even local conditions, the different types of local conditions. You don't go to a worship, for example, at the temple every day, but you speak Chinese every day. If you don't go to the temple, I mean talk about example of tradition, then you won't be punished, at least in this world, maybe in the next world. If you go to the church, you don't go to the temple, you will be punished in hell. That's another world. But if you don't speak, eat in Hong Kong, then you can't. You will be like a dummy. You can't. And if you go to court, if you can't speak, if there's only one language, English language, if you don't speak English language, you're a son. You need an interpreter. So immediately you can see the difference. Is there any common thread? I tried to make it. Trying to find one, but probably some resemblance, but not exactly the same. I try to say that, if the law is so flexible and connected and can deal with the local circumstances, why cannot the system handle difference in language, and you can see all these difficulties.
We would like to take one more question from our audience. And the gentleman at the front.
Thank you. Just a two-part question. Firstly, Mr. Chan, you've mentioned about the quality over the Chinese language used by the other genders. So do you have any occurrences of such, or could you elaborate on the reasons of such? Second part is you raised concern about the quality of Chinese writings, Chinese mastering the language of Chinese by some of the judges. Just can you elaborate whether you find is about the writing, or is about the wrong choice, or whatever. What are the examples that you face? The second part was about, I feel I'm obliged to ask this question because you were one of the ones in the New Council and also graduates of this university and this faculty. Do you find the university could have handled the incident with regard to the recent controversies, chain of controversies? Could it be handled better?
Can I refuse to answer the second question? It's outside the scope of this talk. The first one, I can see that in fact, you can actually see it in the judgments, you can see it and hear it in the courtrooms. In fact, I can tell you, all court proceedings are recorded now. And if there's any doubt, senior officers, senior judges, who simply listen, supposing you are a magistrate, there's a complaint against you. If I were to adjudicate, I would listen to the recording. And I think, you know, in many occasions, I actually simply find that they've been using really loose languages. I mean, when I describe vulgarity, indecency, it's probably not their fault. It's probably the way younger generations were educated. I mean, when I read the newspaper this morning or yesterday, and about the Form 6 examination, you know, when you say, "Mama la," this is the younger generation. So our magistrates are young. 7 years, 4 years. So they will be adopting from it. They use it all the time. So that's why there's a slight decline. It's not only the magistrates, the judicial officers, but also generally the population. We've been using our language too loosely. So I can see the drop in standard in both the oral as well as the written form of the language. I can see that how would I put it? Some of the magistrates, actually we all have trainings in first training on the languages, on the right judgments. We have trained, and in fact, I can tell you one very embarrassing situation. I took part in one of these training sessions. There was a Chinese teacher teaching about 6 or 5 of us. So we were supposed to, this is a small group discussion, so we were supposed to hand in our written judgment to her, so that she would correct our written judgment, and then we can discuss it among ourselves, the 5 of us. But she was very nice. She said, "I don't want to embarrass anyone. When you send out to us, what I'll do is I'll block your name, so that we can actually freely discuss your judgment, style of writing, without knowing who was actually the author." Right? So the 5 of us, you know, at the small class, we were supposed to do. Nobody else did except me. So I was, as the chief judge, I was, you know, almost class prefect. So I got over 3 of my judgments and sent it to the teacher, and she duly made corrections. And this is not good. Start, this is bad Chinese. I mean, she made all these things. So, the next class, we discussed, you know, this particular judgment. The judge actually made a mistake here. So, and then when we were discussing, everybody laughed. Because they immediately knew that I was the author. You know why? because the teacher deleted my name without deleting Chief Judge of the High Court. So everybody knew it was my product. So he was laughing and laughing. He said, "Look, I bet you your judgment is probably less attractive than mine. You better show your own." They never did. So the teacher only discussed all three judgments of mine. And I was criticized for a few hours. So there you are. Now, to be fair, it's not a matter of standard. Sometimes it can be a matter of style. I mean, the teacher said, perhaps you can write it better in this way, rather than this way. But there you are. You can never have sort of perfect English or perfect Chinese. So that's tolerable. That is acceptable. But you can see poor Chinese or poor English immediately sometimes. So there you are. I guess that all judges will have to improve themselves from time to time. And I think the best thing to do is actually to do more reading, both in English and in Chinese. There's no easy way out.
Well, just ended with a light-hearted example. I come across a case many years ago. It was an indecent assault case, and as soon as the defendant touched the victim, a female victim, the female victim responds by saying "siman diwale," and literally it probably means "you better behave yourself." When it is translated, it said "please be gentle."
This is the end of the Q&A section, and we would like to thank Justice Chan and Professor Chan for spending the evening and sharing your experience with us. And before we end the event tonight, we would like to invite Mr. Peter Sidoko, a university librarian, to resend souvenirs to our guests as a token of thanks. And Mr. Sidoko, please. And then may we invite Dr. Wong Chi Chong, Assistant Director of General Education, to present souvenirs to our guests as a token of thanks. Dr. Wong, please. May we invite Mr. Peter Sidoko and Dr. Wong back to the stage to join us for the photo taking section.
Thank you.
afraid I may have to ask for permission from the Chief Justice to assess it.
Thank you, Justice Chan, Professor Chan, Mr. Pierce, Sidoko, Dr. Wong, our audience, as well as staff from the Law Library and the General Education Unit. And this is the end of the event tonight. Thank you very much, and we will look forward to seeing you soon. Thank you.